I had posed the same question in the morning, and I was asked to ask the question to Dr. Zakir Naik. There are three questions, actually. The first one is, Islam says on the day of Qiyamah, the ruh will rise to reach Allah. Can you explain the ruh in scientific terms or in consciousness? Being a doctor, I think you should be in a position to enlighten me.
Well, that was the question, that in Islam it says that on the day of Qiyamah, the ruh will rise. What is ruh? What is this ruh? He wants to explain scientific terms. Ruh, if you translate, means soul. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Imran, chapter number 3, verse 185, Allah says that every soul shall have a taste of that. Every soul shall have a taste of that. Kullu nafsin zaikatul maut. Every soul shall have a taste of that. The Arabic word ruh is translated as soul. In terms of science, can I explain scientifically the concept of soul? See, human being is normally made up of a body. There's life and soul. Without soul, human being is as good as dead. Therefore, Quran says that in the sleep, the ruh goes away and comes back. Physically, the human being is living. He's living. It's like somewhat like a taste of death. You know, there. It is like, you know, when you sleep, your ruh goes away. The person is physically alive. In scientific terminology, death is, as a doctor, cessation of life. Means if your heartbeat stops, if your brain stops, you are dead. In Islam, Islam doesn't agree with this scientific meaning. Therefore, Allah says, death will come to you. In Islam, death is a thing. It is not cessation of life. As a doctor, in medical terminology, death is cessation of life. Heartbeat stops, brain stops, EEG is flat, heartbeat stop, ECG flat, man is dead. In Islam, Allah says in Surah Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 2, Allah says that He has created death and life. Allazi khalaqal mauta wal hayata. Allah has created death and life to test which of you is good in deeds. So death is a creation. It is not cessation of life. In scientific terminology, if life is not there, it is dead. In Islam, it's not like that. And Allah says in the hadith, on the day of judgment, Allah will get the death and He will destroy it. Means after this world is finished, in the hereafter, there will be nothing like death. It will be destroyed. So that is how we differ between science and Islam. And one thing to be noted, brother, that science has not reached so far. It can describe everything. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator. He is the khaliq. He is far superior than the best scientists of the world. He is our creator. He is the best scientist of the universe. And I have given a talk on Quran and modern science. And I have proved in that talk that this Quran is not a book of science. S-C-I-E-N-C. It's a book of signs. S-I-G-N-S. It's a book of ayats. There are more than 6,000 ayats, 6,000 signs in the glorious Quran, out of which more than 1,000 speak about signs. Though it's not a book of signs, many things told in this Quran 1,400 years back, science has come to know recently. 50 years back, 100 years back, 200 years back. It speaks about the creation of the universe, the Big Bang, which science came to recently. It speaks that the earth is spherical in shape, which we came to know recently. It speaks the light of the moon is reflected light. It speaks about botany, that the plants are made in sexes, male and female. It speaks about creatures and human beings created from water. It speaks about geology. It speaks about biology, about embryology, and on, more than 1,000 verses. But what I say, whatever the Quran speaks about science, 80% of it, what it speaks, has been proved to be 100% correct. Yes, I'm answering your question, brother.
Be specific and ruh.
That's what I'm trying to tell you. You told me, prove scientifically. See, your answer, now you're cutting short the answer. You told me, prove to me scientifically about ruh, so I'm trying to prove to you scientifically, being a medical doctor. I told about death, now I'll come to the ruh, I'll come to it, and then I'll give you answer. I'm here, I'm not running away. I'm here. Because you were scientifically there, therefore my answer has to go to science. If it was only Ruh, I would have kept science aside. So if what the Quran speaks about science, whatever the Quran says about some things, 80% has been proved to be 100% correct. 80%. The remaining 20% is ambiguous. Neither right, neither wrong. What my logic says, when 80% is 100% correct, the remaining 20% is ambiguous. Not even 0.1% is proved to be wrong. Neither right, neither wrong. So what I say, inshallah, God willing, even that 20% will be right. So Quran talks about heaven, which science hasn't discovered. Quran speaks about life after death, which science hasn't discovered. Quran speaks about jinn, which science hasn't discovered. Quran talks about ruh, science hasn't discovered. So human being is made up. Allah says he has put the ruh in the human being. So scientific terminology, we know about the body. Science hasn't reached far to talk about the ruh. Therefore, I'm telling you that science doesn't talk about ruh. Maybe after 50 years, 100 years later, 200 years later, like how science didn't speak about Big Bang. They came to know recently, but Quran mentioned 40 years. So scientifically, science hasn't advanced so far to talk about ruh. But today science tells us that when an animal dies, there's no loss of weight. But when a human being dies, immediately when he dies, there's loss of weight. So some scientists have said that this loss of weight can be attributed to soul. The animals have no soul. I'm not talking about later on when there's Iger mortis and all. But immediately when a human being dies, there's immediate loss of weight. So scientists say it can be this loss of weight is because the ruh goes away. So this ruh is the main Allah says has blown the ruh into every human being. It is a soul. Scientifically we can't describe. It is the word of Allah. It is the ruh. So scientifically this ruh, this body will die. Allah says in this world we come, we die. Again we'll be resurrected. On the day of judgment we'll be resurrected. We'll come back to life. So main thing is the ruh that is there. So depending upon the good and the bad deeds you do, if you follow the commandments of Almighty God, you go to Jannah. If you don't follow the commandments, if your bad deeds are more, you go to Jahannam, hellfire. So this ruh is the main thing which is there, which science so far hasn't described because science is not that advanced. Hope that answers the question.
Do you have a related question?
How do you experience the beauty of the ruh within your body? If you can't explain scientifically, at least tell me, what does it do to your body? There must be a way, some way you can experience the goodness of this particular
the
soul,
brother has asked
which
the
makes
question.
A difference.
The brother has asked the question, you can experience. If you can experience, how can you not prove scientifically? Brother, many things we can experience which we can't speak scientifically. So I gave you a full talk to prove that
has to be subjective.
I'm not blindly believing in soul. It is a logical belief. And I've told you scientifically that what the Quran says, I'm not blindly believing in hell. So you tell me, how can you prove scientifically about hell? I can't. How can you scientifically prove about heaven? If you can't prove it doesn't exist. So what I'm trying to tell you, brother, I am a student of science. I'm a medical doctor by profession. Many things science hasn't advanced because the doctors don't know. So what this soul, Allah says, is the main thing of the human being. This soul will go, and that will be the main thing in the hereafter. So what we have to do, brother, in this world is follow the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we follow the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the next life, in the next life, we go to Jannah. If we don't follow, if we disobey, we will go to Jahannam.
Okay, you are talking about the cardiac arrest and the brain death, right? Now,
brother, you are talking about cardiac arrest and brain death. See, again, now you're asking me some things of medical science which I don't know. Are you a medical doctor? You're a medical doctor, fine. In cardiac arrest and brain death, there's something like...
No, exactly, my point comes up from there itself. You say a cardiac arrest, a person dies. And you said...
I never said that. Did I say that?
No.
Did I say that?
You didn't say. But
so why are you putting words in my mouth? I never said that in cardiac arrest, you have to die. You may die, you may not die. I'm a doctor. And you being a doctor, there's something...
That's exactly what my point is. When a person has a cardiac arrest, if we revive him a couple of minutes time, he survives.
What
makes a difference? So that's exactly my question.
Now what you're talking about is suspended animation.
Exactly.
You know? Exactly. You're a doctor, speak suspended animation. We have several cases. You have asked a question, let me reply. See, question should be short, the answer is there. You ask a question, let me give you the reply. You are talking about cardiac arrest. You know, in cardiac arrest, we see the pulse is gone. We see the pulse is gone, ECG is gone, we try and revive, we pump the heart. We put a fibrillator, cardiac, ventilator, whatever, he may come back. We are trying to revive. So therefore, in Islamically, he hasn't died. But medical terminology, if the brain is flat, EEG, ECG said is dead. So how can science, how can he be revived? So that's what we say, that science is limited. Many a time the person is revived even after 5-10 minutes. We know cases, as medical doctors, that people have been revived after 10-20 minutes. Right or no? So in Islamically, he's not dead. Islamically, he's not dead. The rule is there. Medically, we can say, okay, EEG is flat, ECG is flat, the brain is not functioning, it is brain death. Many a time, the person goes in coma. Brain death, but he's living. Heart is pumping, brain death. So we say brain death. That's a medical terminology. But the person is yet living. He's not dead. Only brain has died. So today, when we say medically, brain should not stop functioning, the brain should stop functioning, heart should stop functioning, pulse should not beat, and we have got 10 criteria. It keeps on changing. The definition of death keeps on changing. Therefore, in Islamic terminology, death is not the same as medical death. Death is not the same. Death is a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, in Hindi we say, Mot aati hai. Death has come. You say, what death has come? In scientific terminology, it is garbage. Death doesn't come. When life ceases, death is there. But it is right. In the Hadith and the Quran, it says death comes. Death come means it is not only absence of the living functions. In Islamic terminology, it is far superior to that. Death means the soul has gone away. And it may include cessation of heart, then the brain stop functioning, EEG is flat, ECG is flat. That is one of the criteria. So therefore, I say death according to science and death according to Islam differs. So that is the beauty of Islam when it talks. And soul is the key. The soul yet remains. The human body dies. Yes, thank you for agreeing.
No. That's exactly where I was trying to bring you down to. Now the question is, does this soul get into the body on the day of Qiyamah and raise it? That was the main question. I think now this you please answer that.
Ah, simple question. If you can go back and see the cassette, your question was different. Your question was scientifically, can you say what is Ruh and Du? And then in the ending you say, does this soul get into the body? So that was a part which I thought was not that important. What you said, scientifically prove the soul, what is soul, and you gave a... Okay, fine, your basic question is, does the soul enter the body? Simple question. Seven verses of the Quran. Now, I'll go to the background because maybe you may not be having knowledge of what the Quran says. Yes, the soul goes into the body. Now you'll ask, what body? Body has disintegrated. You know, people are buried, body has gone, disintegrated, some people are burnt. Hindus are burnt, Muslims are buried, we have been dust. Allah gives the reply. In Surah Qiyamah, chapter number 75, verse number 3-4. Allah says, when they ask you that how will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be able to reconstruct the bones on the day of judgment, Allah gives the reply. Tell them, Allah can not only reconstruct the bones, He can even reconstruct the very fingertips. Today science tells us, it was Sir Francis Gold in 1880, who discovered the fingerprinting method and said that no two fingerprint even in a million people are identical. So Allah is talking, reconstructing the body, reconstructing the bone, He can even reconstruct in perfect order the very fingertips. So this is the reply Allah gives. He can reconstruct and the soul will put and hisab kitab the day of judgment. Allah says in Surah Al-Imran, I'll just complete the ayat which I quoted. Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse 185, Kullu nafsin zaiqatul maut. Every soul shall have a taste of death. But the final recompense will be on the day of judgment. All those who have entered Jannah and saved from the hellfire, they have achieved the objectives of this world. For this world is nothing but plain amusement. Hope that answers the question.
My name is Ramesh. I am doing my final BE. So my question is, why many Muslims are not following the Zakat? They have clearly mentioned, now only I came to know about Zakat and everything in this exhibition. So many of them are not following the Zakat. So what is the main reason behind it? So if they follow it, there won't be any poor people of Muslim who are ready to go for the interest kind in the loans. So they can really avoid it if they do the Zakat, those who have the wealth. So I want, with your speech, make them to do the Zakat. Thank you, sir.
Brother asked the question that why don't all the Muslims pay Zakat? You have to ask them, not me. Alhamdulillah, I do pay my Zakat. Alhamdulillah. Allah has blessed me, has given hidayah to me, and I do pay my zakat. But I do agree with you, brother. What you're saying is right. That most or many, I haven't gone and done a survey, but I do agree with you, many Muslims don't pay zakat. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Anfal, chapter number 8, verse number 28, Allah says, your wealth and your children are a test for you. This wealth is a test for you. You know, normally people say, you know, that, and I've given talks on this topic, that wo gareeb insaan hai, poor aadmi. Allah tells different people different ways. Though gareeb aadmi, that poor man, in zakat he gets 100 out of 100, he has to pay no zakat. We think are gareeb aadmi hai. But actually in zakat, in the subject of zakat, he gets 100 marks. 100 out of 100. Why? He doesn't have to pay zakat. Zakat only has to be paid by those people who are the saving of more than the nisab level, more than 85 grams of gold. He or she should give 2.5% of their excess wealth in charity every new year. Now many people, most of the Muslims, alhamdulillah, pay zakat. But they don't pay what they have to pay. They may say, I've got so much wealth. This doesn't come in the category of paying zakat. You know, so they avoid that. They give zakat. According to me, majority, almost all give zakat, but not how much they should give. Many give, alhamdulillah, 100%. Some give more. Some give 75% of what they should give. Some give 50%. Whatever is excess, you should give 2.5% on that. For example, you have one house is allowed. If you have 3-4 houses, all the other houses you should give zakat. If it's not being used. You know, people have 5-6 flats, one in Bombay, one in Chennai, one in Bangalore, all, you know. And you only live one house, you know, to live. So all excess that you have to pay zakat. So people, but they try and go for fatwa hunting. You know, fatwa hunting, you go on the internet, fatwa hunting. Oh, bhai, iske upar zakat ne, uspe zakat ne. So try and find a scholar who will say, zakat is not valid on this. The criteria for zakat, brother, is given in Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 60. Where Allah says that zakat can be given, should be given to 8 categories. To the fuqaras, to the poor, to the masakin, to the needy, to the mualla futu al qulub, those whose hearts are coming towards Islam, to amilun, those engaged in collection of zakat, to the gharimun, those who are debtors, to the rikab, those who are in bondage of slavery. 6. Number 7, to ibn sabil, the wayfarers, and the last category, fi sabilillah, in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the duty of every rich Muslim who has a saving of more than nisab level should give zakat. In short, I would like to end my answer. Zakat means to purify. It means to grow. So if you purify your wealth, inshallah, you're securing your wealth, it will grow more. So those people who want even more wealth, the more you give zakat, Allah will secure it. Like in how you do insurance, you know, insurance. There's insuring with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says in Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 33-34, that warn to them those people who hoard wealth, hold gold, and do not spend it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Give them a warning that on the day of judgment, they'll be branded with the gold in hellfire. That gold will be taken and be branded with it on your forehead, on your back, and on your flank. And say, this is the gold you hoarded, have a taste of it. So if you think you're going to hoard gold, Allah gives a warning in Surah Tawbah chapter 9, that on the day of judgment, the gold you have hoarded and kept with you, Allah will take that gold and in the hellfire will make it hot and brand you with that gold on your forehead, on your back, and on your flank. Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm a converted. Past 3 months, I've converted into Islam. There's just one question that keeps coming to my mind about the non-vegetarian part of Islam. Could you please explain me the significance of sacrifice, and is it a must that a Muslim who does not take non-vegetarian is not a Muslim?
The sister has a question that why do Muslims have non-veg, and can a Muslim be a Muslim if he does not have non-vegetarian food? Is it fard in Islam? Sister, a Muslim can be a very good Muslim even by being a pure vegetarian. It's not fard in Islam that you should have non-veg. There's no verse in the Quran that you should have non-veg, or no hadith in which the Prophet said, if you don't have non-veg, you're not a Muslim. For being a Muslim, you should follow the 4 criteria, Iman, righteous deed, watawasaw bilhaq, watawasaw bisabr, you go to Jannah. There's no criteria that you should have non-veg. But you asked me the question, what is the logic that we have non-veg? Regarding the second part, You can be a good Muslim even by being a pure vegetarian. It's not farz. But what is the logic? The logic is, if Allah has given his permission to have non-veg, why should we not have it? Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 1, lawful for you is the meat of the fourfold animal with the exception named. Allah repeats the message in Surah Nahl, chapter 16, verse number 5, that you can have the meat of the animal. Allah repeats in Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 21, that verily in the cattle is a lesson for you. We give you to drink from what is within the body. From it you get warmth, and of the meat you can eat. So if Allah has given permission, why can we not have, why should we not have? Now scientifically, if we analyze, that the flesh food is rich in protein and vitamin K. Normally our body requires amino acid, 23 amino acids, out of which 8 are known as essential amino acids, 8 essential amino acids which are not synthesized in the body, which has to be given by external diet. There is no vegetable food which has all the 8 amino acids, essential amino acids. No vegetable food. Even the soya bean has. It is only the flesh food, meat, mutton, beef, fish, which have all the 8 amino acids. So it is nutritious. Coming to the logical aspect of it. If we analyze the set of teeth of the herbivorous animal, which only have grass, which do not touch flesh food, cow, goat, sheep, they have a herbivorous set of teeth, they have flat teeth. If we analyze the set of teeth of the carnivorous animal, which only have flesh food, lion, tiger, leopard, they have pointed set of teeth, they have a canine set of teeth, they have a carnivorous set of teeth. If we analyze our set of teeth and we go and look in the mirror, Almighty God gave the flat teeth as well as pointed teeth. If Almighty God wanted us to have only vegetables, why did he give us the pointed teeth? For what? For having non-veg. Furthermore, the digestive system of the herbivorous animal, the cow, goat, sheep, it can only digest vegetables, it cannot digest fresh food. The digestive system of the carnivorous animal, lion, tiger, leopard, can only digest flesh food, it cannot digest grass and vegetables. But the digestive system of the human being can digest both vegetables as well as flesh food. If Almighty God wanted us to be pure vegetarian, why did he give us a digestive system it can digest both? To have it. Furthermore, people have a misconception that non-veg is prohibited in our religion. Our religion means Hindus say, and they think all the major scriptures of the world, they give permission to have non-veg. Even the Hindu scriptures, if you read Hindu scripture, Manusmriti, chapter number 5, verse number 30, Almighty God says that Almighty God has created some animal to eat and some to be eaten. If you eat the animals which God has created to be eaten, you're not doing a sin. Manusmriti, chapter number 5, verse 31 says that Almighty God has created some animals for sacrifice. If you sacrifice the animal which are meant for sacrifice, you're not doing a sin. Again, the message repeated in Manusmriti, chapter number 5, verse number 40, that you can kill the animals which are meant for sacrifice. There are, in Vedas, Rig Veda and all, there are quotations that sages and saints had beef, they even had cow. If you read Mahabharat, Anushasan Parv, chapter number 88, the eldest brother of the Pandavas, Yudhishthir, he asked Bhishma that what should we give in Yagna, in Puja, so that our ancestors will be satisfied. So Bhishma says, you can check the references, Mahabharat, Anushasan Parv, chapter number 88. If someone is thinking I'm pulling a fast one, you can go home and check it out. I'm giving references from my memory, Alhamdulillah, by the God-given computer. Bhishma says that if you give herbs and shrubs, vegetables, our ancestors will be satisfied for 1 month. If you give fish for 2 months, if you give meat for 3 months, if you give rabbit for 4 months, if you give goat for 5 months, if you give bacon for 6 months, if you give birds for 7 months, if you give deer for 8 months, and the menu continues, if you give buffalo for 11 months, if you give cow 1 full year, if you give cow in Yagna, for ancestors, they'll be satisfied for 1 full year. And if you want to satisfy your ancestor inexhaustibly forever, give the meat of rhinoceros. So this is the full menu. You can have fish, you can have vegetables, you can have birds, you can have deer, you can have buffalo, you can have beef. It's there in your scriptures. Several references. The reason why some of the Hindus say that you should not have non-veg, they started being influenced by other philosophies like Jain philosophy, which even in their scriptures they give permission. But when you ask these people, why don't you have non-veg? They say, see, killing living creature is a sin. Therefore, we prefer having vegetables. Now science in advance have come to know that even the plants have got life. So when you have vegetables, they're taking life. So now the logic explains, yes, Brother Zakir, plants have got life, but plants can't feel pain. Therefore, killing a plant is a lesser sin as compared to killing an animal. Today, science has further advanced and we have come to know that even the plants can feel pain. The plant even feel happy, they can even cry. But the cry of the plant cannot be heard by the human ear, because human being can only hear between frequencies of 20 cycles per second to 20,000 cycles per second. Anything below and above this, the human ear can't hear. You may have heard of the silent dog whistle. The dogs can hear up to 40,000 cycles per second. In the silent dog whistle, the master blows the whistle, the frequency is about 20,000 cycles per second, but below 40,000 cycles per second. The dog can hear, human beings can't hear. So even the plants can feel pain. So there was non-Muslim who argued with Maxim, Brother Zakir, I agree with you. Plants have got life, plant can't feel pain. But the plants have got about 2 or 3 senses less. They only have 2 or 3 senses. The animals have got 5 senses. Therefore, killing a plant is a bigger sin. So I told him, for sake of argument, I agree with you that plants have got 2 senses less. Animals have got 5 senses, plants have got 2 or 3 senses. For sake of argument, I agree with you. But I asked him a question. Suppose you have a brother who's born deaf and dumb. Cannot speak, cannot hear. When he grows up, somebody comes and kills him. So will you go and tell the judge, oh my Lord, give the murderer less punishment because my brother was deaf and dumb? You will tell him, give him a bigger punishment. Usne masoom ko mara, he has killed an innocent human being. In Islam, it doesn't work like that. Less senses, 5 senses, 3 senses. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 168, eat of the things which are lawful for you. What is halal for you, you can eat. What is tayyab for you, can eat. What is good, you can eat. Basically, sister, if the non-Muslims in India don't have non-veg, I've got no problem. Because if everyone in India starts having non-veg, the prices of mutton and beef will go high. So personally, I've got no problem. But if someone comes and argues with me, you're doing a sin, that's the time I reply. So it's not for having non-veg, but if you like it and if you have it, there's no problem. Hope that answers the question. And for more details, refer to the debate. I had a debate with the Jain, the president of the Indian Vegetarian Congress. The topic was, is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? He tried to prove scientifically that non-veg is haram. Human beings should not have it. And I've given the reply. You can refer to the video because it's about 4.5 hours debate. It's a very hilarious debate, mashallah.
As per Quran, every Muslim, if he is good, will go to heaven. There are yesterday you have seen a program in Aztec TV where they have shown a lot of Adivasis. Those Adivasis are so much lack of knowledge that they don't even wear dresses. They don't, in that case, they won't be having access to Quran, Bible, or any Hindu Veda also. In that case, if they die, where will they go? Suppose if you say that they will go to hell, won't it be a curse on them, they'll be sent to hell?
A non-Muslim brother asks a good question, that he says that if a person is a good Muslim following Quran and Sahih Hadith, he'll go to Jannah. What about those people like Adivasi who have not heard about Islam? So, and if they are put in hell, so Allah is unjust, na'uz billah. And the question is a very logical question. But Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 40, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is never unjust in the least degree. He's never unjust. But the question is a logical question. Point number 1. Today in the age of science and technology, what your question would have carried weight maybe 50 years back, 100 years back, today in the age of science and technology, hardly you can say there's any human being who does not know about Islam, who has not heard about Islam. But even if I agree with your question, that hypothetically there's an island in which some human beings are living, which no one in the world has met them, they haven't been told about Islam. So if they die, where will they go? Andaman Nicobar, I have gone to Andaman Nicobar Island, I have given a speech also. So to say they haven't heard about Islam is wrong. I have given a speech in Port Blair. And even in, so the age of science and technology. By satellite, the speeches are going there. They see my lectures in Andaman Nicobar. So to say that Andaman Nicobar have not heard about Islam, I don't agree with you. But hypothetically, suppose there is an island, people who have not heard about Islam, what is their status? There was a resurgence on two tribes, on the Kapauku tribe and the Astro.